Hey guys, what's up? It's Alex Torelli, and welcome back to The Hand of the Day, where we are going to break down an interesting hand of poker I played on a high-stakes online cash game. I'm going to learn about strategy, how to outplay your opponents, and how to hand read better in this video. Stay right here. Hey guys, and welcome. If you're new to the Conscious Poker YouTube, our mission here is to turn good players like you into great ones by providing the best strategy, content, and mindset content on the internet. So hit that like button, subscribe to this channel if you're new, and be the first to know when awesome new videos come your way. This hand kicks off. I was playing a online cash game. We're playing 10/20, and it's the biggest game in this online poker room. So you expect the caliber of players to be pretty good, as well as the biggest VIPs, because typically they converge around the biggest game because the best players are going to play there, and then the biggest whales are going to play there. So it's this really interesting, fun dynamic. All the tables are anonymous, so I don't really know anything about the players. But in this particular hand, I know that the small blind, who's the villain in the hand, has been 3-betting a lot recently. I don't have specific stats on him or whatever, but I just noticed that he's been really aggressive from the small blind, 3-betting a lot when I open the button. So what I've done is an adjustment here, when it gets folded around to me, is instead of making a bigger size open, like making it 50 or 60, what I decided to do is make it 40, which is a min raise. And the reason I do that is because it allows me to get a better price on my raises preflop. And because the small blind is giving me a lot of trouble by 3-betting a lot, the adjustment is to raise smaller because now I can start to call his 3-bets. So I take away the power of the 3-bet because I'm not in a spot where I have to fold preflop because there's more stack remaining relative to the size of the pot. So it's a deeper, what's called stack to pot ratio. So when I 3-bet smaller, and when I raise smaller, excuse me, and he 3-bets, we now have more chips behind. So I can start to call with more hands and put him in a tough position post-flop by playing more pots in position. So the two adjustments to make versus aggressive opponents are, first, tighten up your range. Open with fewer hands so they cannot just 3-bet you punitively. The second is to raise smaller, which allows you to call with more hands. So that's what I've been doing. He doesn't know that yet, but it's a quick adjustment that I made seeing that he's 3-betting too often. So I make it 40, he makes it 175, big blind folds, and I opt to call with King 10 off. Now this hand is a little bit marginal in a normal, not necessarily normal, but against a really tight opponent who's not 3-betting often, I might fold this hand preflop, but against this guy who's 3-betting a wide range of hands, meaning a lot of his hands, maybe as high as 15%, my hand's going to have a better chance of winning. Plus, I feel like my post-flop edge being in position is going to compensate, and I could play this hand profitably. I call, and we take a flop. The flop comes down gin for me. 10-10-9, rainbow. He bets out 100 into a pot of 380. Now, before we get to this fork in the road where we can either call and trap or raise for value, I'd like you to pause this video right here and leave a comment below on what you would do and why. And I think it's really important to articulate why you would do what you would do against an aggressive opponent like this, because that makes sure that you're making the right play for the right reasons and not just stumbling upon the right play. And I'm gonna go through this video and pick the best comment, and we are gonna give away a free 3 months to our membership at Conscious Poker, which is some of our premier content with hundreds of videos and a course, or multiple courses in there, to help build your poker game from the ground up, working with your fundamentals, poker math, and hand reading, like we're talking about in this video. So go ahead and leave a comment below and let me know your thoughts. Okay, so picking back up in this hand, the guy bets 100, and in a situation like this, a lot of the time I would just call. Calling is sort of the standard play here. I think it's good for your overall balance, good for your overall range. It makes you a little bit more challenging to play against because it's hard for your opponent to know if you're floating, hard for him to know whether you have trips or just a nine or pocket fives or ace high. With a bet size this small, calling is definitely a viable option. What I decided to do, on the other hand, is go for a raise here. And the reason is that I felt that our dynamic was such that he was 3-betting me often enough that he was gonna think I was getting frustrated that he was playing so many hands and I was going to now bluff him. So I thought that he was on that level. And a point I've articulated many times in these videos is that The goal in poker is not to be on the highest level. It's not to necessarily say, I'm going to call and balance my range because that's the GTO strategy. That's fine if you're solving for a test that you want to take to prove your knowledge. But if you're trying to make the most amount of money, what's important is to understand what level your opponent is on and be one level higher. That's the game. That's just the simplistic approach to how to win at poker. Because if your opponent is the worst player in the world, play strong hands and beat him. If he's the best player in the world, you're going to have to try and maybe quit that game or just be one level higher. So there's a huge delta in how many levels you can think about depending on who your opponent is and how the ebbs and flows of the game are dictating what level he's thinking on based on what he thinks you're thinking. And you could go back and forth in that virtuous cycle to figure out what level he's on and then be one level higher. So I thought he was going to think that if I raised, that I would be bluffing because he was playing so aggressive, I was getting frustrated, and now I was taking a stand. So he would interpret my raise as a bluff, as weak. Whereas other times he might interpret my call as weak, but I didn't think that in this spot. So I went ahead and made a raise, and the key here is the sizing of this play. Because you can make a raise to 400 or 500 and take away the option for your opponent to bluff raise you again or to float you with a call. So what's happening at these higher limits in these more interesting dynamics in these games is that players are not folding to raises, they're doing what's called floating, which means calling with a marginal hand to win the pot on a later street. So they're defending when they have anything because they feel like you're bluffing. And what happens here is a lot of times the turn will go check, check if he calls, and then he'll then bluff out on the river. So that allows him, thinking multiple streets ahead, that allows him to call the flop with some weaker hands, planning on taking the pot away on a later street. So I gave him that rope by making it 280 here on the flop. So he bets 100, I make it 280. And the reason, again, is to allow him to continue with a wider range of hands, allow him to continue with more hands on the flop to keep his worse hands in the pot so I could win more money from them. See what I'm doing here? I'm trying to win more money from these hands, right? Keep them in the pot. So he goes ahead and call. Now we're building ourselves a nice pot for the turn. The turn comes down a blank, complete blank here on the turn, and he checks. So the pot is now about 900, 950. And again, I want to keep the most amount of his hands in the pot. I want to make it look like I'm bluffing, and I also want to set this up for a river jam. I don't need to bet big here, and this is a big mistake I see people make, is they get the logic right, they understand the reasoning with the hand reading, but then they bet too big, and they take away their opponent's bluff, and they make it more difficult for him to float with worse hands. So what I did is bet 300 here. Now that serves two purposes. Again, it allows him to potentially check raise all in on a bluff if he was floating the flop with ace high or king queen or queen jack or queen king jack, sorry, or 8-7 or queen 8 or any of these floats, he can now check raise all in on the turn as a jam. Or if he was floating the flop with a marginal hand, like maybe a small underpair or a 9, he's not priced out. He can call again because he's getting such good odds. He's going to call, then he's going to be hung on the river because the bet size on the turn makes the pot 1,500 if he calls, and I have enough chips left that I could jam all in on the river for a 3/4 pot size bet on the river if he calls the turn, and it's just a natural way to get all the money in. I don't need to bet any bigger to accomplish my goal of getting it all in by the river. So you want to be thinking one step ahead. How big should you bet based on how big the pot will be if he calls and how big your remaining stack will be? So you're going to have to do some math, just basic addition and subtraction here, but it could really help you think multiple streets ahead for how big you need to size your bets to get all your chips in by the river. So I had that plan formulated on the flop. Raise small, bet small, jam. I don't need to bet any bigger. I could keep his range wider and allow myself to win more money. He goes ahead and calls, and we go heads up to the river. Now, before we get to the results, if you like the process I'm using here of kind of figuring out what my opponent has, how to narrow down his hand, and how to structure my bets accordingly to win the most money, I encourage you to check out my hand reading system. I put together my blueprint for hand reading and how I go through this process in pretty much every hand I play and how you can do it as well in your own game. It's totally free. It's at the link below. Just enter your email. We'll send it right over. It's a beautiful PDF. And you'll also be opted in for our newsletter, which comes out every Monday, called Crush Mondays, which is the best poker content we put out on a weekly basis, and poker strategies, exclusive hand of the days, questions and answers from my clients, and much, much more. So check that out at the description below. So on the river here in this hand, it comes down to nine. So it's a really interesting river in this spot, because some hands are counterfeit, all the draws missed, and if he has a nine, hopefully now he's going to stack off. Doesn't really change that much because I'm basically representing a 10 or nothing. So if he has nine, he has a boat, but he only really beats a bluff. I hope that makes sense because my range on the river is basically a 10 or a bluff. So a full house with nines full or just two pair with nines and tens is pretty much the same hand relative to the hands that I have. So now in this spot, he goes ahead and jams, which makes it really easy for me because I have a boat, and so it's pretty easy to know what to do. But in this spot, it's interesting because the types of hands he's jamming with are either a boat, which is tens full, which is kind of weird to jam because it doesn't really make sense to jam with tens full because he's only going to get called if I have the same hand. It's better for him to check and pick off a bluff. So it doesn't really make sense to jam with tens full. It doesn't make sense to jam with a 9 because he only gets called by a 10, so why would he jam with a 9? And again, he could pick off bluffs if he has a 9. So the only hands that make sense to jam are hands that are bluffs that were floating the flop in the turn that have no showdown value. So what are those types of hands? Go ahead and again, pause this video and leave your thoughts in a comment below. We're going to pick the best one and give you 3 months to our membership for free. What types of hands jam this river? I gave you a few clues. What do you think he has? I go ahead and call this river, and he turns over pocket fours, which makes a lot of sense to jam because he can't check call with four high, and he wants me to fold if I was bluffing. And he thinks there's a good chance I'm bluffing when he jams here with pocket fours because he thinks there's a chance that I have something like queen jack, king jack, or just a complete random bluff. So you can see how here, by setting this hand up for out-leveling him by thinking one level higher, it made him jam this river because he didn't think I had a hand for value. He thought I had a bluff, and he tried to play his hand to get me to fold that. Turns out I had a monster, ended up calling, winning a nice size pot, and we doubled up. I hope you enjoyed this video. Be sure to subscribe to this channel. More awesome content's coming, and I'll see you in the next Hand of the Day.